صل على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله بارئ الخلائق الأجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء حبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد
والصلاة والسلام على أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين لا سيما ولي الله الأعظم حجة الله ابن الحسن صاحب الأمر والزمان.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفداء ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين. صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله. صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة يا غريب الغربة يا مذلول كربلاء. السلام على من جعل الله الشفاء في تربته. السلام على من الإجابة تحت كبته. السلام على ساكن كربلاء. فيا ليتنا ثم يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي. يا سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، قال مولانا إمام جعفر بن محمد وهو أصدق الصادقين صلوات الله وسلامه عليه.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
إن زيارة الحسين تعدى الحجة مقبولة زاكية مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم صدق الإمام وآمنا به زينوا مجالسكم بذكر محمد وآل محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
The second of your loudest salawat in honor and in order to hasten the reappearance of Mawlana Sahib al-Amr wa al-Zaman.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Ahibai, the sacrifice of Karbala, as we pointed out before, is a tragedy which is an exception throughout the passage of history, such that no other Nabi from the Anbiya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had to give a sacrifice in order to save the message of Tawheed in the way Sayyidah Shuhada had to. And no other Wasi or Wali after Sayyidah Shuhada has been required to give a sacrifice to the extent that Sayyidah Shuhada did in order to save the message of Tawheed. For Imam al-Hussein, between these two different passages of time, in the past, before 61 AH, and in the present, yani after 61 AH till today, the Qadiyya and the sacrifice of Sayyidah Shuhada stands out as an exception. Because the sacrifice and the revolution in itself was unique from every possible dimension when one analyzes Karbala, you will see that even the rewards and the punishment that is attached in regards to the enemies of Imam al-Hussein or in regards to the commemoration of the legacy of Sayyid al-Shuhada, you see that these rewards are also exceptional. The Sharia, which is the most beloved code of conduct, the Sharia, the sole reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed 124,000 prophets to mankind, such that they may follow a Sharia and through this Sharia obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When it comes to the Qadiyya of Sayyid al-Shuhada, even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changes the Sharia for Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. How? Entum. Pick up a Risala Amaliya. Any Risala Amaliya. Look into any of the hadith from Wasa'il al-Shia or Mustadrak or Tahdib or Istibsar, books of the Fuqaha who are the fortresses of Tashayyu'. You will find that to eat the earth as sand is haram. La yajuz. It is a sin if a person picks up under a normal situation, hukmul awwali, as the fuqaha say, to pick up sand or a handful of dust or earth or grass and consume it. The Sharia says haram. Yet when it comes to the dust of Sayyid al-Shuhada, not only does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala change this hukum from haram to mubah, not only does it change from haram to mubah, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you obtain this earth, which is the earth of Karbala, where Sayyid al-Shuhada is buried, the hukum changes from not only haram to mubah, but from haram to mustahab. Not only does it remain mustahab, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, take from the dust upon which the body of Hussein lies and you will gain shafa'ah. The Sharia, Allah changes it for Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. Ya Zahir, know the value of the person at whose doorstep you are standing. Pick up any book of fiqh, whether from the ulama or narrations of the a'imma. Traditions state that idharul jaza' ala al-mayyit makruh. To display anguish over the death of any given person is makruh. If a person's mother or father or brother or sister or friend passes away, the Sharia commands us that yes, you have the right to experience your grief. Yes, you have the right to cry relentlessly, but when you display anguish over the death of a mayyit, there is a limit, because the Sharia has ordained that during times of death, we must ensure and implement sabr. Therefore, to express intense anguish is makruh. And in certain cases, fuqaha will tell you that over a mayyit, if you were to hit your face out of anguish or scratch your face out of anguish, there is a kafara that needs to be paid. There is a fine that needs to be paid. Because Allah has ordered us to express or to implement or to practice sabr. Hukum shar'i. That when a death occurs within the community, you must implement sabr. But yet, look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changes the sharia to Imam al-Husayn, where Imam al-Sadiq says to display anguish, idharul jaza' li sayyid al-shuhada mahbub. When it comes to the event of Imam al-Husayn, to display anguish to the highest level, whether it is through matam of hitting the chest or hitting the face, to the extent that it causes bruising or bleeding, Imam al-Sadiq says, this is mustahab for Imam al-Husayn. The poet used to come, very famous poet, and you will see his lines, perhaps even on the walls in Iraq. He would come and he would recite, he would say, Hubbul Husayn ajannani. The love of Hussein has made me insane. A person who does not scratch his face or hit his face or hit his chest over the death of his father. A person will not walk barefooted to the janaza of his father. But when it comes to the ziyara of Sayyid al-Shuhada, he will walk barefooted and hit his chest. Sharia changes for Sayyid al-Shuhada. This person says, Hubbul Husayn ajannani. The love of Hussein has made me insane. The love of Imam al-Husayn has made me mental. But I can't think. I am submerged in his love. For another poet comes forward and says, in a very eloquent manner, Jununi lil Husayn dalilun ala akli. It is my insanity over Imam al-Husayn that is a proof of my intellect. If I do not go mental for Sayyid al-Shuhada, then I do not have any intellect. This is that Sayyid al-Shuhada. When he gave his sacrifice, the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala began to shake. Ta'rifun, what is the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The sacrifice unique from every perspective. Sayyid al-Shuhada gave his life to protect the Sharia. Allah expresses his gratitude for Sayyid al-Shuhada by making some of the laws of the Sharia to bow down to Sayyidina Shuhada. But Hassan comes and asks, Sheikhna, bayanat like this is a tuhma. Bayanat like this will instill a source of ihana or degradation for the Sharia. Why should we perform or why should we make bayanat like this? Habibi, alcohol is one of those liquids that are from the Aynul Najasat. From the Aynul Najasat, the person who consumes alcohol is liable for punishment in the pits of Jahannam. And a liquid or a substance which is hated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the greatest extent. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you under Hukm al-Thanawi that if you are stranded and you are about to die, you are at the brink of death, in order to save your life, Allah tells you this substance which is haram, this substance which is hated to me, I give you permission to drink it. Rather, I make it for you wajib to drink such that you may save your life. The idea is, if that a substance as najis and as haram as alcohol can be made wajib under Hukm al-Thanawi, then what is the Sharia when it comes in front of Sayyid al-Shuhada, who gave everything for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? These are rules and ahkam that need tadabbur and tafakkur. These are ahkam, ma'rifah of Sayyid al-Shuhada, that needs a heart of aqidah to understand. For the sacrifice of Karbala, unique from every dimension. In terms of its reward, unique as well. In the tradition that we mentioned, Imam Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa
sallam.
Imam al-Sadiq mentions or makes a declaration. إن زيارة الحسين تعدل حجة مقبولة زاكية مع رسول الله. The Imam says that the performance of the ziyara of Sayyid al-Shuhada is equivalent to performing a Hajj. Which type of Hajj? There are thousands of millions of people who go for Hajj. Some of them their Hajj is maqbool, some of them their Hajj is not maqbool, some of them their Hajj is mabroor, some of them their Hajj is not mabroor. Say Imam al-Sadiq says, the one who performs the ziyara of Sayyid al-Shuhada, the reward is equivalent, or his position is equivalent to the person who has performed a Hajj which is accepted, maqbula indallah, zakiyatun, a hajj which will refine his interior. Not only this, he is given the reward of a person who performs hajj with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa alayhi
wa sallam. Mu'mineen who wish that they were with Rasulullah in Hijjatul Wida, when he made the universal declaration and said, Man kuntum mawla fa hada aliyum mawla fal yuballigh ash-shahid minkum al-ghalib. Allahumma waliman wala wa aadiman aada. Allahumma ansur man nasara wa khdhul man khadalah. If you wish to have been with Rasulullah and be part of that khutbah adhimah ghadiriyah, if you wish to have performed the rites of Hajj and Tawaf with Rasulullah, if you wish to have performed the sa'i between Safa and Marwa with Rasulullah, if you wish to hit the Jamarat with Rasulullah, if you wish to have slept the night in Arafah with Rasulullah, Imam al-Sadiq says, perform the ziyarah of Sayyid al-Shuhada. If the Imam in this declaration draws a similarity or he draws an analogy between Hajj and Ziyarah, because in this declaration, in this hadith, he says, Inna Ziyarat al-Husayn tu'adil hajjatul maqbula. He says that performing the Ziyarah, before we go any further, something between the brackets. When the Imams speak, the Imams, the master of the Fuqaha, the Imams are the master of the Fuqaha, Imams, Sadatul Balagha, at the peak of Balagha. Abbasan can't come forward and say, well, if this is the case, we should leave performing the wajib Hajj and come for the ziyarah of Sayyid al-Shuhada. Because the wajib Hajj, the one time which is wajib in our life, according to the Fuqaha and in the usage of Hadith, is known as Hijjatul Islam. So the first wajib Hajj is known as Hijjatul Islam. Any other tradition that you find where the word Hajj is used without the expression Hijjatul Islam is an expression of the Hajj which is Mustahab. So nobody can claim that we are performing any sort of shirk or kufr or have no respect for the Sharia. La, rather we defend the Sharia through the commemoration of Sayyid al-Shuhada. In any case, the Imam says that performing the ziyarah of Sayyid al-Shuhada is equivalent to performing a Hajj with Rasulullah, Hajj which is Mabrur. The Imam draws an analogy between ziyarah and Hajj. If there is an analogy drawn between Hajj and Ziyarah, this means because they are at the peak of eloquence and they are at the peak of Balagha, there must be certain similarities within the practice of Hajj and within the practice of Ziyarah. What are these two similarities? There are thousands of them. The first of these similarities comes under the philosophy of Hajj and the philosophy of Ziyarah. Philosophy of Hajj and philosophy of Ziyarah. See, entum ayyuhal mu'mineen, when you go for Hajj or when you go for Umrah and you perform your tawaf around the Kaaba Sharif, the starting point of your tawaf is the Hajar al-Aswad. The ending point of your tawaf is the Hajar al-Aswad. Such that if you began your tawaf after the Hajar al-Aswad, your tawaf is naqis. And if you end your tawaf before the Hajar al-Aswad, again your tawaf is naqis. And if your tawaf is naqis, especially if it is tawaf al-Hajj, then there is ishkal in the validity of the Hajj. Therefore, the Hajar al-Aswad is a center point of the Hajj. Tell you, what is this Hajar al-Aswad? Allama al-Majlisi rahmatullah alayhi in Bihar al-Anwar records a narration, sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
The Imam narrates a tradition in Bihar al-Anwar, or which is recorded in Bihar al-Anwar by Allama al-Majlisi, sixth Imam, where he's talking about the realm of existence known as Alam al-Dhar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created our souls thousands and thousands of years before He created our bodies. So our souls were created in a realm known as Alam al-Dhar. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the souls of the entire mankind, whoever is born from the time of Adam till the day of judgment, even those beings that are not born right now, who will be born next year or the year after, their souls are already created and are in a realm of existence known as Alam al-Dhar. For the Imam says, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the souls of the entire humanity in Alam al-Dhar, He compiled or He gathered all these souls. And then he cried out to these souls, which one of you attests to my rububiyyah, anna la ilaha illallah, and which one of you attests to the risala of my most beloved one, yani ashhadu anna muhammadan rasulullah, and which one of you attests to the wilaya of his wasi, yani ashhadu anna aliyan waliyullah. The narration says that a number of souls went forward and pledged allegiance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over the shahada, la ilaha illallah Muhammadan Rasulullah aliyyun waliyyullah. So there are a number of souls that gave or pledged allegiance or gave a covenant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there are a number of souls that didn't give a covenant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For therefore, look at the hikmah ilahiyya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to those souls that have given the pledge of allegiance to his and attested to his lordship and to the Nabuwa of Rasulullah and to the Imamah of Amir al-Mu'mineen, those souls that pledged allegiance and attested to their position, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that I will send you to the alam al-dunya and I will see how truthful you are to this covenant. And on the other hand, those souls that were reluctant or those souls that did not give the bay'ah, who did not attest to the rububiyyah of Allah, who did not attest to the nabuwah of Rasulullah, who didn't attest to the wilayah of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, no problem, you are reluctant in the shahada in alam al-dar, out of my mercy, I shall give you a second chance to go into the dunya, and I shall provide for you anbiya and awsiya, who will guide you to this right path, and I shall give you a second chance to make this covenant and pledge allegiance to these three faculties. La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, aliyyun waliyullah. As the souls were giving bay'ah, there was an angel that was present in Adam al-Dhar, and this angel was a witness to the bay'ah of each and every human being that attested to the shahada, la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah aliyyun waliyullah. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then took this angel and transformed the angel into a stone which is known as the Hajar al-Aswad. At that time it was white, and he placed it and he commanded Nabi Adam that this Hajar al-Aswad must be placed on the corner of the Kaaba. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the Hajj wajib, such that when you come for Hajj, and this is why you will see in the dua which is taught to us by Imam al-Sadiq, when you come for Hajj or when you go for Umrah, when you reach the Hajar al-Aswad and if you get a chance to kiss it, you say from the dua that is recommended to recite when you are kissing the Hajar al-Aswad, you say, Allahumma ishhad li biwafa'il ahd wal mithaq. Ya Allah, bear witness that I have fulfilled the pledge and the covenant. This is what you do when you go to the Hajar al-Aswad. Which pledge, which covenant, which ahd, which mithaq? The ahd and the mithaq that you took in Adam al-Dhar. So therefore, when you come for Hajj, the philosophy of Hajj is that this covenant that you took with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Alam al-Dhar, that la ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, Aliyyun Waliyullah, this ahad, this covenant which you took in Alam al-Dhar, you are fulfilling it in the dunya, and you have come back to the stone, and to the angel which is in the form of Hajar al-Aswad, and you kiss it and you tell him, or you tell the stone, the same way that I pledged allegiance in Alam al-Dhar, I am truthful to my covenant and following up with this covenant in the dunya. You bear witness for me. Hajj is nothing but an expression of your loyalty and your covenants towards Muhammad and Ali Muhammad.
Rali. renewing the covenant that you took in Adam and Thou, and renewing the covenant that you took to follow, not only believe in these divine personalities, but follow in their footsteps in the Bible. Father, a point between the brackets. Ziyara is also a demonstration of your wilaya. When you walk into these atabat al muqaddasa, try as much to impersonate the state of mind of the Ansar of Sayyid al-Shuhada. Why were the Ansar of Sayyid al-Shuhada distinguished from the rest of mankind, such that Imam al-Hussein says, I do not know of any companions better than my companions? These are the words of a ma'soom Imam. When Imam says, I don't know of any companions, Imam has ilmul ghaib. What he is saying in a very eloquent way, there is no companions from the beginning of time till the end of time who will be similar to these 72 companions whose doorstep we are sitting at. Ajib. Rasulullah had companions in Badr. Rasulullah had companions in Hunayn. Sayyid al-Shuhada says, my companions are better than the companions of Badr. Ajib. Imam Sahib al-Amr, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif. The entire humanity is waiting for his dhuhur. يملأ الأرض عدلا وكستا كما ملئت ظلما وجورا. The Imam who will come and fill the entire world with peace and justice after it has been filled with injustice and inequality and oppression. The entire world is waiting for this Mahdi. This Mahdi is waiting for 313 to reappear. Yet Imam al-Hussein says even those 313 cannot match the 72. In fact, the 313 seek inspiration from these 72. What distinguished them? Their aqidah in wilaya of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Their ma'rifah of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Until when you go into the Atabat al-Muqaddasa, when you step into the Haram al-Sharif, walk in with a wilaya which is as staunch, with an aqidah which is as staunch as a mountain. When every step that you take towards the Haram, repeating your tongues and in your mind that my master is Ali ibn Abi Talib, even if it was at the point of death, I would never substitute my Mawla for anybody else. Why? Even the Anbiya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made them to obey Amir al-Mu'mineen. Why? In Alam al-Dar, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the souls, did we not talk about Alam al-Dar? We said that Allah created the entire souls and placed them in Alam al-Dar from before Adam till the day of judgment, without exception. If you say without exception, that means even the souls of the Anbiya were present. Which is why Allah, Allah, ya Shi'at Amir al-Mu'mineen. This is a ni'mah to call yourself a Shi'a or a Mawali or a Muhib of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Why? Imam al-Sadiq was once asked, Yabna Rasulullah, how did the Anbiya become the Anbiya? How did the Ulul Azam become from the Ulul Azam? What distinguished them from the rest of mankind? Allah, Allah, Imam al-Sadiq says, Saru Anbiya bi wilayatina ahlal bayt. The Anbiya became the Anbiya because they were the first ones from the entire soul of humanity to attest to the wilaya of Ahlul Bayt. Adam became Safwatullah because he said, Ashhadu anna aliyyan waliyullah. Musa became Kalimullah because he said, Ashhadu anna aliyyan waliyullah. Isa became Ruhullah because he said, Ashhadu anna aliyyan waliyullah. Nafsun Nabi, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to describe Amirul Mu'mineen, those people who have problems digesting the fada'il of Amirul Mu'mineen, whether they are from within the madhab or outside the madhab, ponder over the Quran in the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduces Amirul Mu'mineen in the Quran. Sometimes you see that Amirul Mu'mineen is described when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna a'tayna kal kawfar. Kawfar, the pound of Jannah, sahibul kawfar, Amirul Mu'mineen. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to describe Amirul Mu'mineen, Suratul Hamd, Ihdina Siratul Mustaqim, Siratul Mustaqim, Sirat Amirul Mu'mineen, as for the riwayat of the Amma and the Khassa, ulama of the Shia and the Ahl Sunnah are of the opinion that the tafsir of the verse Siratul Mustaqim is Sirat Amirul Mu'mineen. Bila Ishkal, one of these texts being what is at the top of my mind, Yanabi ul Mawadda, books from the Mukhalifin. For look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduces Amirul Mu'mineen with fada'il which cannot be comprehended in its reality. Inna a'taynaka al-kawthar, Amirul Mu'mineen. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim, Amirul Mu'mineen. Innama waliyukum Allah wa rasuluhu wal-ladina yukimuna as-salata wa yu'tuna az-zakata wa hum raki'un, Amirul Mu'mineen. Kul ta'alu. ادعوا ابناءنا وابناءكم ونساءنا ونساءكم وانفسنا وانفسكم. When Allah wants to introduce Amirul Mu'mineen to the entire world, He doesn't say that He is Amirul Mu'mineen. He doesn't say that He is Yabna Abi Talib. He doesn't say that He is the best one from Ali Ibrahim. He says that He is Nafsun Nabi.
Allah.
What is the position of this Nafsul Nabi? We said every Nabi has attested to the wilaya of Amirul Mu'mineen. Look at the relationship between Rasulullah and Amirul Mu'mineen. In the event of Mi'raj, look what Allah says in the Quran. فَدَنَا فَتَدَلَّ فَكَانَ كَابَ قَوْسَيْنِ أَوْ أَدْنَى فَأَوْحَى إِلَيْهِ الْجَلِيلُ مَا أَوْحَى. Rasulullah in Mi'raj got to a point where he's close at the Quran says, فَكَانَ كَابَ قَوْسَيْنِ أَوْ أَدْنَى. The highest point of proximity towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A point where even Jibreel is not able to get there. And then the Quran says, فَأَوْحَى إِلَيْهِ الْجَلِيلُ مَا أَوْحَى. There was a conversation that occurred between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah. What is that conversation? We don't know. For awha ilayhi ma awha. Huh? The narrations tell us when the Lord of the universe wants to communicate with Khatabul Anbiya, He will communicate with him with the voice of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Sayyid al-Shuhada, the son of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Enter when you walk into the haram, walking with the Aqeedah of Abbas, walking with the Aqeedah of Habib ibn Madahir, walking with the Aqeedah of Wahab. These people were distinguished because of their ma'rifah of Amir al-Mu'mineen, even Wahab. Why? Because the fada'il of Amir al-Mu'mineen are even mentioned in the original scripts of the Injil. For Shahid, coming back to our main topic, Hajj is an expression of wilaya, in that you are going there to renew the covenant that you took with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Alam al-Dar, that you will follow the rule, you will attest or you will submit to the rububiyya of Allah, and you attest to the nabuwa of Rasulullah and to the wilayah of Amir al-Mu'mineen. When you come to the ziyarah of Sayyid al-Shuhada, is there any other thing that occupies your mind other than renewing your allegiance to Sayyid al-Shuhada and to his father, Amir al-Mu'mineen? No. When the ziyarah arba'iniyya, when you stand at the Haram al-Sharif and you say, ma'akum, ma'akum, la ma'a aduwikum, in the other ziyarat when you say, ana silmun liman salamakum, wa harbun liman haramakum, wa aduwun liman adakum, this is the silm and this harb, this strong attachment and connection that you have with Sayyid al-Shuhada, you are fulfilling this connection for a pledge that you took in Alam al-Dhar. So just like the way Hajj is an expression of renewing your covenant to Ahlul Bayt, which you took in Alam al-Dhar, in the same way, Ziyara is a completion and a renewal of the Ahad and the Mithaq, the pledge that you took with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Alam al-Dhar. Which is why in one of the ziyarat of Sayyid al-Shuhada, from the number of ziyarat that are there, in one of the ziyarat you stand in front of the Dari al-Mubarak and you say, Ya Aba Abdullah, ishhad li bi wafa'il ahdi wal mithaq. Ya Sayyid al-Shuhada, you bear witness for me that I have fulfilled the pledge that I took to obey you and your fathers and the nine imams from your lineage on the day of judgment. For Hajj and the ziyarah from this dimension of philosophy, renewal of the pledge, renewal of the covenant with Ahlul Bayt, these two spiritual journeys are mushtarak, which is why our sixth imam says that the performation or the performance of the ziyara is equivalent to Hajj from this dimension. Rather, a lot of the adab and the akhlaq of performing Hajj are similar to the adab and akhlaq of performing the ziyara. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. When you go for Hajj, what is required from you is that your heart is humble and that you are filled with khushu when you walk towards the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You bow down your head and you walk in the peak of humility. Similarly, when you come for Hajj, when you walk towards the Haram of Sayyid al-Shuhada and you walk towards the Haram of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, you walk with humility, with your head bowed down out of respect. Just like when you go for Hajj, the hadith tell us that every step that you take towards the Kaaba, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala writes for you a hasana and forgives your sins. Similarly, when you come for the ziyarah of Sayyid al-Shuhada, for every step that you take towards the Haram al-Sharif, Allah forgives your sins and Allah writes for you hasana. It's a comparison between the rewards and the adab and the akhlaq of Hajj and ziyarah. Enter when you go to Makkah al-Mukarramah. Makkah is known as the land of Aman. Similarly, Karbala al-Muqaddas is known as the land of Aman for the Shias of Ali Muhammad. Enter when you go to Makkah, when you go for Hajj, you perform tawaf around the Kaaba, crying for forgiveness. Enter when you come for ziyarah, you perform tawaf around the Dari of Sayyid al-Shuhada. Enter when you go for Hajj, you wear two pieces of white cloth as ihram. Enter when you come for ziyarah, your ihram is your black cloth. Enter when you go for Hajj, you go between Safa and Marwa, which are from the Shah شعائر الله. انت when you come for زيارة, you walk between بين الحرمين, between سيد الشهداء and أبا, between سيد الشهداء and أبي الفضل العباس. If a mountain such as Safa and Marwa can be from the شعائر الله, then the حرمين الشريفين of أبو الفضل and سيد الشهداء is the شعائر الله الكبرى. Just like the way in Hajj you have the Zamzam, in Karbala you have the Furat. Just like the way when you go to Hajj, your talbiyah is labbaik, Allahumma labbaik. Enta when you go for ziyara of Sayyid al-Shuhada, your talbiyah is labbaik, Ya Hussein.
Labbaik, Ya Hussein. Labbaik, Ya Hussein. Labbaik, Ya Hussein. Labbaik, Ya Hussein. Labbaik, Ya Hussein.
Ya Ali,
Zindabad,
Zindabad, Zindabad, Murdabad, Murdabad,
Muhammad,
Muhammad,
for the sake of Sayyidah Shuhada, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept every one of your hajjans and your desires for the dunya and the akhirah. Sayyidah Shuhada, Abul Fadl al-Abbas, my akidah is that nobody can come to Karbala al-Muqaddas and leave empty-handed. The mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is embedded within Sayyidah Shuhada. If Allah cannot be bakhil, then the madhar of the rahmah of Allah is in Sayyid al-Shuhada. Even if you didn't have the full ma'rifah of Sayyid al-Shuhada and i'tiqad, not even my belief, but the belief as per the madhab, that even if a non-believer, non-Shia was to come to Karbala, but with a sincere heart was to ask for his hajat, Sayyid al-Shuhada would not turn them away empty-handed. They say this is a false claim or an emotional claim. How can it be an emotional claim? Do we not read in the Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ قُتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتًا بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ يُرْزَقُونَ. Have you ever, the verse of the Quran says that those people who were killed in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are not dead, rather they are alive. Enter when you're visiting Sayyid al-Shuhada, you're not visiting the qabr of Sayyid al-Shuhada, you are visiting Sayyid al-Shuhada by himself. You recite in the ziyara, Ashhadu annaka tara makani wa tasma'a kalami. You say, I bear witness that you can see me and you can hear me. To visit the Imam just now is as if you are visiting him in his lifetime. Have you ever read within the seerah of Ahlul Bayt or the seerah of Sayyid al-Shuhada that during the lifetime of Sayyid al-Shuhada, a kafir came, asked something to Imam al-Husayn and he was not given and was sent empty-handed? Never. If in his lifetime Imam al-Husayn never sent a kafir away empty-handed, what makes you think after he has gained shahada that he will send a kafir home empty-handed? Akidah, Shabab. Yes, a person's benefit from ziyarah can be different as per his ma'rifah. A person's according to the ma'rifah, the ajar is according. Some person, according to his ma'rifah, the thawab of a ziyarah is one hajj. Some person whose level of ma'rifah is greater, his thawab is 10 hajj. Some person whose ma'rifah is higher, 25 hajj. Somebody who's at the peak of ma'rifah, 1,000 hajj. The increment in thawab is as per your ma'rifah. But even if you come here not knowing anything about Ahlul Bayt and just ponder over their mablumiyah, you will not go empty handed from thawab. This is a given. Yes, there is tafawud, differences in the daraja of thawab. But going back without anything, mustaheel. Even if you do not get anything for the akhirah, at least you will get something from the dunya inside the shahada. Rahmatullahi al-wasi'ah. If we go away from Karbala empty-handed, where will we go? Who will we ask if we can't ask Sayyid al-Shuhada? Even death can be changed in Karbala. Ani, I want to narrate for you an account that happened. And perhaps you have heard about this event over the internet or YouTube or any social media. But one of the khutaba is very dear to us, narrates. It says, I was in Karbala, Muqaddas, and as I was at the shrine of Mawlana Abul Fadl. As I was sitting in the Haram al-Sharif, I saw a person, young man, come with his mother on a stretcher. And she was at the brink of death, literally taking her last breath. This person came and put his mother by the dari of Abul Fadl al-Abbas. He took a step back and he said, Mawlana Abul Fadl al-Abbas, my entire life I have heard that you are Babul Hawaij. My entire life I have heard people saying that whenever you are in difficulty, Abbas can save, Abbas can guarantee and make that difficulty easy. He says, Mawlana Abul Fadl al-Abbas, today I have come to you with my mother who is at the brink of death. He says, Mawlana Abul Fadl, I don't have anybody in this dunya except my mother. I have no one to love me. I have no one to care for me. Mawlana Abul Fadl, I get down on my knees and I beg you, cure my mother. He continued asking, asking, asking. But the breaths of this lady became fewer and fewer, and she was approaching death faster and faster. This person loses hope. At the end, this khatib says the people who were there witnessed that this woman stopped breathing. The woman stopped breathing. The son saw this. He stood up and he said, Mawlana Abul Fadl al-Abbas, how could you do this to me? How can you do this to me? You are Babul Hawaij. Why did you not listen to me? He says, Abul Fadl al-Abbas, I'm going to Najaf al-Ashraf and I'm going to complain to your father Ali ibn Abi Talib until you didn't listen to me. The tradition says, or this khatib narrates, that the person came out of the haram of Abul Fadl al-Abbas telling everybody, don't go to the haram of Abul Fadl, he's not Babul Hawaij. Ali, I had only one person in my life, my mother. And even this mother of mine, he didn't have enough mercy. Don't go to Abbas. The tradition says, or the khatib says, waqi, and he went towards Najaf al-Ashraf. He left the borders of Karbala al-Muqaddas. He was walking towards Najaf. He sees that there is a horseman that is approaching him. The horseman stops and asks him. He says, oh man, where are you going? He says, I'm going to Najaf al-Ashraf to Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. The person, the horseman asks him, why do you want to go to Ali ibn Abi Talib? He says, I want to go and complain about Abul Fadl al-Abbas. He didn't cure my mother. Then the khatib says that the horseman told this person, don't worry, your mother has been cured. Sit on the horse, I will take you to Karbala. He said, ah, your mother is cured, but I beg you, do not go to Ali ibn Abi Talib. The person says, I sat on the horse. He brought me back into Karbala. He says, when I got on the horse, I found out, or I figured out, that the horseman was without any arms. The horseman was without any arms. This Abul Fadl said to him, I cure your mother, just don't complain to my father Ali ibn Abi Talib. Tradition of Khatib mentions he came back into the Haram al-Sharif and his mother is standing by the Dari al-Muqaddas thanking Abul Fadl al-Abbas and praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
enter, know deep inside your heart that when you are at the door of Babul Hawa'ij, if Babul Hawa'ij wants, the condition is the ikhlas in your heart and sincerity in your heart. Even Malakul Maut will have to take permission from Babul Hawa'ij. This is not a hulu, this is a reality. Allah has given Abu al-Fadil this daraja because of what Abu al-Fadil gave for the waliullah, what Abu al-Fadil gave for the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is not surprising that the angels are at their service. You started your day, mu'mineen, by looking at the blessed water of Farad. And you began your day weeping for Abul Fadl and Abbas. And I feel it is only appropriate that we end our day also by weeping for Abul Fadl and Abbas. One of the most difficult things for a man who is not only a normal man, but a rajul shuja', battle, a warrior at the peak of courage, at the peak of bravery. The most hardest thing for him is that when he can seek revenge from his enemy, he controls his anger and his emotion and he keeps quiet. Do you know what went through the heart of Abu Fadl al-Abbas when Amir al-Mu'mineen was returned back to his home on 19th of Ramadan after being struck with a sword? Abu Fadl says, Mawlana Imam al-Hasan, this is Abdur Rahman who struck my father. I am Abbas. I can take my revenge from him. Imam Hasan says, patience, Abu Fadl. Imam al-Abbas doesn't utter a word. Sam'an wa ta'atan li imami zamanih. In respect and obedience for the Imam of his time. The same Imam al-Hasan, when his janazah is being taken towards the haram, when his haram is taken towards the haram of Rasulullah, Marwan ibn Hakam, together with people from Bani Umayyah and who were led by Aisha, come forward and she cries out and says, Allah, Allah, ya Bani Hashim, la tadkhulu fi bayti man la uhib. She cries out, oh Bani Hashim, Allah, Allah, oh Bani Hashim, do not bury in my house the person that I do not love. An indication was given. The narration mentions that they shot 70 arrows at the janazah of Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba. The narration mentions that Abu Fadl al-Abbas, together who was standing, holding the janazah with Muhammad ibn Hanafiya. Together with Muhammad ibn Hanafiya and the rest of his brothers, Muslim bin Akil, Ja'far al-Tayyar. The tradition mentions that Abu al-Fadl stood up and he was about to remove his sword from his sheath, crying out, oh Bani Hashim, how is the janazah, how is the body of Abu Hasan attacked while we are alive? If Abu al-Fadl wanted, he would have made Medina into a city of blood. How dare somebody attack Imam al-Mujtaba while Abu al-Fadl is standing? The narration mentions Sayyid al-Shuhada went to Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. If he wanted to take revenge, he would have killed them. He would have shed their blood and Imam al-Hasan would have been buried by Rasulullah. But because of the wasiyah of Imam al-Hasan, look at how Imam al-Husayn approaches his brother Abu al-Fadl, because he knows how beloved Imam al-Hasan is to Abu al-Fadl. The narration says, فَجَاءَ إِلَيْهِ الْحُسَيْنِ فَضَمَّهُ إِلَى صَدْرِهِ وَكَبَّلَهُ بَيْنَ عَيْنَيْهِ. The tradition mentions, to calm Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, not Imam
Imam al-Hussein went and he hugged Abu Fadl al-Abbas. He kissed him between his eyes on the forehead and he said to him, Akhi Abbas, laysa laka hadha al-yawm. He says, this is not your day. Laka al-yawm a'adam min hadha. You have a day which is much greater than today. It's the day of Ashura. When the companions were martyred one by one, and the Bani Hashim were standing there, each one competing with the other to get permission from Sayyid al-Shuhada to go into the battlefield. The narration mentions that the first person to go into the first person to seek for permission was Abu Fadl. He went and he sat down Imam al-Hussein. And he says, my master Abu Abdullah, how can I be alive while our children and our nephews and our cousins are being killed in front of us? This is Qasim, the son of my brother Hassan. How can I carry his dead body while I am alive? How can anything happen to Ali ibn Akbar or the children of Muslim bin Akil while I am alive? I am Kamal Bani Hashim. I will give my life, but I shall not see a hair on their head to be harmed. Allah, Allah, Abu Fadl, you couldn't stand for a hair on the head of the children of Ali Muhammad to be harmed. Abu Fadl, where were you when Shemar came and slapped you? The poet says at one time, Sukaina on the 11th of Muharram, she threw herself on the body of Imam al-Hussein. She says, the narration, Hamid ibn Muslim says, that as much as the enemies would pull Sukaina from the body of Imam al-Hussein, they couldn't. So Shimmer came and said, whip her until you separate her. The poet says that when the first lash hit the back of Sukaina, the body of Abu al-Fadl began to by the Al-Kabah of Allah, return the arms of Abbas so he can defend Sukaina. Allah, Allah, Mu'mineen, this is the night of Abu al-Fadl. Do not stop your tears. Allah, Abu al-Fadl, Bab al-Hawa'ij, Bab al-Husayn, inshallah, through him your hajjat are accepted. Tradition mentions that Imam al-Hussein didn't give permission to Abu al-Fadl to fight. Abadan, he would look at him and he would say, you are the commander of the army, you are the flag bearer of the army. The children of Bani Hashim, the people of Bani Hashim went into war one after the other. Abu al-Fadl helped Sayyid al-Shuhada carry back the body of Ali ibn al-Akbar. It was Abu al-Fadl who consoled Imam al-Hussein when Qasim was killed. It was Abu al-Fadl who consoled Imam al-Hussein at every stopping point until there remained nobody from the camp of Imam al-Hussein except himself, Abu al-Fadl, Imam al-Hussein, the infant Abdullah al-Radi al-Ali al-Askar and Imam Zayn al-Abidin. No one in the camps of Imam al-Hussein. At this time, Abu al-Fadl comes to Imam, who is seated in his tent. And to me, I've all been to the Mukhayyam, I've been to the Khaymah that today. Vision in your hand, the Khaymah of Sayyid al-Shuhada, sitting on the bare sands of Karbala, covered in the blood, the grief of his children being killed in front of him. Abu al-Fadl comes to him in a very humble manner with his head bowed down. He says, Sayyidi Abu Abdullah, is there permission for me to go into the battlefield? Tradition says Imam al-Hussein raised his head towards Abu al-Fadl and tears began to stream down his eyes. He says to Abu al-Fadl, you enta hamilu liwa'i, enta, you are the flag bearer of this army, you are the commander of this army, Abbas, so long as you are there, the army of Hussein is intact.
Do you know what this means? The presence of Abul Fadl itself in Karbala was enough to keep the enemies away. It was because of the presence of Abul Fadl that Sayyidah Zaynab Bedou Makhulfum had some sort of security and comfort. Imam Abul Fadl, Imam Abbas, sister Imam Hussein, he says that I am tired and my chest is constrained from the cause of these munafiqeen. As they are talking, you have seen how close the tents were. He hears the cries of the children. Suddenly they burst out into a loud cry, Al-Atash, Al-Atash. From every direction, the children are weeping for water. Imam al-Hussein looks at the children. He looks at his brother, Abul Fadl. He says, if you must go, then take the water bag and fetch water for the children. Abul Fadl al-Abbas looks at his brother Sayyid al-Shuhada. The narration mentions that Sayyid al-Shuhada hugged him. Sayyid al-Shuhada hugged him and kissed him in three places. He kissed him on his forehead.
Oh, whoa.
And then he kissed him on the right shoulder. And then he kissed him on the left shoulder. And he says, Fi sabilillah wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. My brother Abbas goes into the battlefield. Abul Fadl goes into the tent, collects his, wears his armor, wears his breastplate. He takes his sword, he takes his water bag. He has the alam of Islam in his hand. He comes down on his knees and Sakina Urukaya kisses Abul Fadl and the chief. She gathers all the children. She says, bring Hamida, the daughter of Muslim bin Hakim. Bring Hamida, bring the other younger girls. Bring them together, let us sit by the tent. Abbas is going to fetch water. The poet says, if there was any time on Ashura when Rabab smiled, perhaps it was when she heard that Abbas is going to get water. Allah, Allah, there is hope that Ali ibn Askar might get the hope of the entire Bani Hashim on the shoulders of Kamar Bani Hashim. The traditions mention he mounted his horse. He came out of the Khaybagah, his sights far towards the end of the Furat. The traditions mention that Umar ibn Sa'ad boasted 4,000 archers by the Furat, 4,000 of the strongest, 4,000 of the most bravest warriors that are found within the armies of Sham and Kufa. He posted them by the Furat. The tradition mentions Abul Fadl sat on his horse. He came towards the battlefield and he recited his famous poem. Uqatilu al-qawma bi-kalbi muhtadin adibbu an sibtin nabiyyi ahmadin adribkum bi-sarim al-muhannadi hatta tuhilu an kitali sayyidi inni ana al-abbas dhul tawaddudi najlu aliyyin al-murtada al-mu'ayyadi. He introduces himself by saying, indeed I will strike you with a sword that is sharpened to the highest, and I will melt myself in the defense of the family of Rasulullah. I am Abbas, the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib, the one who was protected and helped by the angels. He rode into the battlefield, came charging at them like a roaring lion. It says, the narrations mention that when Abul Fadl came in like a strike of thunder, dispersing the enemies, a strike which is Alawi, a strike which is Haydari, hatta in galaba maymanatahum maysaratahum maysarah. The left flank was moved to the right was dismantled to the left. The archers are dispersed. The son of Haydar has conquered the Furat.
Your boss, your boss.
Allah, Allah, Abul Fadl gets off his horse, stands on the waters, gets into the waters of the Furat. Into Ahibari. You touched the water of Furat today. Tell me, how cold was the water of Furat? How could this this cold water be a source of quenching the thirst of the children of Ali Muhammad. A child who has been thirsty for 3 days, can you envision in your mind if you were to give her a glass of this cold water, what type of smile would this little child be? The poet mentions that when Abulfadl picked this water, he thought about the comfort and the coolness in the hearts and the throats of the children when they drink from this river. He lifts the furat with his hands. Some mention that he wanted to drink from the water, but I say that he wanted to drink from the water, and then he remembered the thirst of Hussein. I say this is not correct. Abulfadl was sahib ismat al-sughra. Abulfadl, not even for a single second of his life would he able to forget the thirst of Imam al-Hussein. When he lifted the water with his hands, it was to show, as if to show the enemies, that if I want the son of Haydar, I can conquer the Furat at any time that I want. And then he lifted the water in his hands and he recited this poem, which is a madhhar and shows the akidah within his heart. Perhaps a point of tabligh towards the enemies. If you want ma'rifah of Abbas, look at this poem. He says, Ya nafsu ba'da al-Husayni huni wa ba'dahu la kunti an takuni. هذا الحسين وارد المنون وتشربين الماء وتشربين وارد المعين هذا الحسين وارد المنون عفوا يا نفس بعد الحسين هوني وبعده لا كنت أن تكوني هذا الحسين وارد المنون وتشربين بارد المعين لا والله ما هذا من فعال ديني ما هذا من فعال صادق اليقين. He says, oh nafs, what is there to live in the dunya if Hussein doesn't live? How can you drink the water? You stand at the cold water while Hussein is placed under siege? Yani Abbas drinks from the water while Hussein is thirsty. La wallah, never. Ma hada min fi'alu dini. This can never be from the action of my religion. Ma hada min fi'alu sadiq al-yaqini. A person who is sadiq, who has the height of yaqeen, can never fulfill or quench his thirst while his master is thirsty. He gathers the water in his water bag. He mounts his horse. He has got between him and the Khaymaga 30,000 of Umar ibn Sa'ad's army. The narrations mention that Abulfadl held on to the alam and he held on to the sword, the water bag around his neck, bypassing the 30,000 people. His only sight is the Khaymaga. His only sight is the Mukhayyam, which is at the end. The only thing in his mind is to get the water to Sakina. His only thought is to get the water to Sukaina and the rest of the children. He comes out of the Furat. He rides his horse towards the Mukhayyam in the fastest pace possible. Umar ibn Sa'ad says, form a barrier between him and the Mukhayyam. Do not let the water reach the tent of Hussein at any cost. If we are not able to attack Abbas on duels, then let us attack him from every direction. The narrations mention that the archers surrounded Abulfadl from every direction. They rained an army of arrows towards Abulfadl. Abulfadl protecting himself with his armor, protecting himself with his shield, coming from towards the Furat, towards the Mukhayyam. He rode through a passage that had a palm tree. The narrations mention that one of the Na'inan positioned himself behind the palm tree. As Abulfadl rode his horse past that tree, the enemy from the Kuffar came and he struck the arm of Abulfadl. Allah, Allah, he said me at the right arm of Mawla Abbas. Imam al-Hussein lets go of the sword. He takes the raya, the alam. He has the water bag with him. He looks at his right hand on the grounds of Karbala. He says to them, in qata'tumu yamini fa inni uhami abadan andini. He says, even if you cut my right hand, I will not cease from protecting the religion of Rasulullah. I will not cease from protecting the family of Ahlul Bayt. With a single hand, Abu al-Fadl continues to ride the horse. At this time, when the enemy see that the jazba, when they see that the courage of Imam al-Abbas has not gone down, a second lion comes from behind the palm tree. The narration says that he struck the left hand of Abu al-Fadl. Allah, Allah, Abu al-Fadl carries the water bag with his teeth. He carries the alam between the chest and what is remaining from the Sabian arms. Here he is sitting on his horse. Abu al-Fadl has no arms, and the arrows are being shot from every direction, from the thousands of arrows that pierce the body of Imam al-Abbas. Allah, Allah, there are two arrows. I don't know which one is most painful. The tradition mentions that one of these arrows came and pierced the eye of Abu al-Fadl. You will not find from any of the shuhada that they were pierced on the head or they were pierced on the eye with an arrow except Abu al-Fadl. Do you know why? Because if an arrow was to be shot towards your face, every one of the shuhada had a hand to protect himself. But Abu al-Fadl could only watch the arrow come towards him. The narration mentions the arrow pierced the eye of Abu al-Fadl. This mountain of sabr, this mountain of courage still remains seated on his horse. And then the arrow which broke the back of Abbas, Allah, the arrow which broke the courage of Abbas, Allah, Allah, the narration mentions that the arrow came and pierced the water bag which Abbas had gathered. The way the water came out of the water bag and fell to the land of Karbala, it is as if the hopes of Abbas went with the water into the sands. It is as if the courage of Abbas went with the water into the sands. Mawlana Imam al-Abbas is sitting on his horse. And this Mazloom Abbas thinks, as the arrows are being shot towards him, how do I go towards the Kaaba of the women? How do I go towards the Kaaba for the women? And if I turn back towards the Furat, Sahih, I will make it to the Furat, but how will I get the water for the second time? My arms have been severed. Allah, Allah, be by the sake of the dilemma of Abbas, Ya Allah, hasten the reappearance of Imam Sahib al-Amr. The narration tells us, as Abbas was sitting on the horse without any arms, and he's not able to see because the eye is pierced, because the arrow has pierced his ear, someone from the La'in, who had become bold after seeing that Abbas doesn't have any arms, he took a poll. The maktal says, فَجَاءَ إِلَيْهِ مَلْعُونَ وَضَرَبَهُ بِعَمُودِ عَلَى رَأْسِهِ. He came with a tent pole and he struck the old man on his head. The narration mentions, فَفَلَكَ حَامَتَهُ. He split open the front skull of Abbas. Abu al-Fadl falls off the horse. Abu al-Fadl falls off the horse. He cries out, Ya Abba Abdullah, alayka minni salam. The tradition mentions Imam al-Hussein went running towards Abu al-Fadl. Little Shabab, even today you walked from the Mukhayyam towards the place of Abu al-Fadl. Until you all walked in a straight line, even back in 61 AH, Imam al-Hussein did the same walk from the Kaimaga to Abu al-Fadl. But Hamid ibn Muslim says there are two differences. Or Hamid ibn Muslim says there are two things that are different for the walk of Hussein. Hamid ibn Muslim says, the first thing that I noticed is that every time Abu al-Fadl, every time when Sayyid al-Shuhada heard the call of Abu al-Fadl, he went running towards Abu al-Fadl. Huh? When Qasim fell down, you see the Maqtal says Imam al-Hussein dashed towards him like a raging lion. When Ali ibn al-Akbar fell, Sayyid al-Shuhada went towards him like a raging lion, quick as lightning. But when it came to Abu al-Fadl, Hamid ibn Muslim says, I saw this man who is covered in blood with a white beard. His back is bent. For every three steps he takes to the Maidan, this man falls onto the ground. He stands up, he takes another few steps, he falls onto the ground. Ibn Hamid says, I went closer. I heard this madloom old man with a broken back cry out, Al-An in Qasr al-Dahri. Allah, Allah, Imam al-Hussein says, now my back is broken. Hamid says, the second thing that I noticed, this is the last of my masa'ib, ya Shi'at Amir al-Mu'mineen. May Allah have mercy on you for your tears for Abbas. The tradition, Hamid ibn Muslim says, I followed this man closer, and as he walked towards Abbas, I noticed that he went down. Every time he would walk, he would fall. But this time he fell down, he remained on the land of Karbala for an extended time. I said, perhaps he can't walk anymore. Hamid says, I went closer to see what this man is doing. I see that there is something in the hands of Hussein. Sometimes he kisses it, sometimes he puts it on his forehead. I said, what is this that he found on the Maidan? Hamid says, I came closer. I saw the Sabian arm of Abu al-Fadl. Hussein would kiss it. Hussein would put it on his forehead.
Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein.